Hi, my name is Mae Bobrin and I'm a Board Certified Behavior Analyst with DiNovi & Associates. In this video, I'll be talking about continuous and discontinuous measurement systems. Continuous measurement means that every instance of a response are recorded during the observation session. One example is frequency. To collect frequency data, you should have the operational definition of what an occurrence of the behavior is. Frequency is the total times behavior occurs in a given observation session. The observation sessions should be the same intervals, and this type of data collection would be used in a free operant condition. Rate is the frequency of the behavior over a specified period of time. So that can be the number of responses per minute, per hour, per day, per week, and so on. Observation sessions can be different lengths since you're converting it into a rate. The measure of temporal dimensions of behavior measures how much time a behavior takes. One example is latency. Latency measures how long a student takes to begin performing a particular behavior. To record latency data, note when you give the student a directive and when the student begins to respond. An example would be responding to requests, making initiation to a person entering a room, etc. Duration is a measure of the total extent of time in which a behavior occurs. It records how long the behavior lasts, and it's used when effective behavior change concerns the duration rather than the frequency or rate. So for example, running, attending, reading, and studying. The time from a reinforcer to the next response is a latency and not an interresponse trial, even if the reinforcer is response produced. Interresponse time is a measure of the number of response opportunities needed to achieve a predetermined level of performance, and it's used as an indicator of the speed of learning. Measured trials to criterion measures how long a student takes to begin performing a particular behavior once it's been requested. Some advantage to a continuous measurement system is that it provides an actual measure of behavior, a point-to-point correspondence between the behavior and the measure. Some disadvantage is that they can be labor-intensive or even impossible given some practical constraints. Discontinuous measurement is a sample of how often behavior occurs in a given observation session. Discontinuous measurement systems are popular in both practice and in applied research. In the Mudford et al. Article, the researchers found that about 45% of studies published in the Journal of Applied Behavior Analysis between 1995 and 2005 used discontinuous measures of data collection. Let's discuss why. There are three types of discontinuous measurement systems: partial interval recording, whole interval recording, and momentary time samples. Partial interval recording is a time sampling method in which the observer records whether the target behavior occurred at any point during a specified interval. Data are presented as a percentage of intervals in which target behaviors occurred. An advantage is that it provides a rough indication of both a rate and duration behavior. A disadvantage is that it generally overestimates true occurrence, and it can be insensitive to large changes in high rate behavior. Although the most common interval in literature is 10-second partial interval recording, it still tends to overestimate actual behavior. Because of this, practitioners should select to utilize partial interval recording for behaviors targeted for decrease rather than for increase. For example, if 10-second partial interval data are collected on in-seat behavior, a behavior targeted for increase, and the student is seated for 1 second per interval, using partial interval recording, data would show that the behavior remaining seated happens for 100% of intervals. Whole interval recording is a time-sampling method in which the observer records whether the target behavior occurred throughout the interval. Data are presented as a percentage of intervals in which target behaviors occurred. An advantage that provides a rough indication of duration of behavior. A disadvantage is that it generally underestimates occurrence of behavior. It can be overly sensitive to reduction in high rate behavior and insensitive to increase in low rate behaviors. It may be more appropriate to use whole interval recording for behaviors targeted for increase, but would require significant behavior change in order to show an increase. Using the previous example, a student would need to go from remaining seated for 1 second to 10 seconds for one interval to be scored. Momentary time sample is a measurement method in which the presence or absence of behaviors are recorded at precisely specified time intervals. Data are presented as percentage of intervals in which target behaviors occurred. Some advantages are that it's easy to implement, not very time consuming for the observer, and more accurate estimate of behavioral duration than partial interval recording and whole interval recording. Some disadvantages are that it may be subject to random error. In general, momentary time sample has been shown to be the most accurate discontinuous measurement system. In the Hanley et al. Article, they found a less than 5% difference in behavioral estimates when intervals were between 5 seconds and 120 seconds.
It is also recommended to measure behaviors targeted for increase.
But it may be difficult to capture low rates of behaviors. So just to recap, for continuous measurements, it may be more appropriate to use when you're measuring discrete behaviors, such as kicking. For discontinuous measurements, it may be more appropriate when you're collecting data on more ambiguous behaviors, like vocal behavior that may have brief responses between words, very high rates of behavior. When collecting data while doing something else, like teaching a class, for multiple target behaviors, and when multiple target behaviors are being recorded at the same time. For additional resources, review the Fiske and Delmolino article, as well as the LeBlanc article. They each feature a decision tree to help identify the best measurement type.
In the Fiske and Delmolino article, there's a decision tree that poses various questions to help a clinician identify what the best type of data collection system would be. So for example, there's questions such as behavior must increase to near 100%, or the behavior must decrease to near 0%. And based on the response, whether it's yes or no, the most appropriate data collection system can be identified, whether that be partial interval recording, whole interval recording, or momentary time sample. There are different cautions for each one that the clinician could also use to guide and inform their decision making.
To disseminate the science, please share this video and follow our channel on YouTube. Thanks for watching.